Well, we're back on Morning Express with the second person of interest this morning. Yes, it is a special day. What can we say? It's almost Christmas. We want to give you a treat. Milly Odhiambo returns on the couch. Thank you for joining us.
Thank you.
So one of my colleagues has just said, Mrembo wa Suba. I haven't heard that before. So maybe you should explain to him and the rest of our viewers who don't understand where that comes from.
Well, that was something that the Mbita people coined for me when I was campaigning.
Right.
That they called me Geza Geza Mrembo wa Suba.
What does Geza Geza mean?
Geza Geza is a Suba word. It's basically the same thing. It's fine, you know. It's good. It's fine.
And I know you wear that name with pride.
Yes, I do.
Okay. Yes. Let's get straight to it. And we begin with what's making headlines in the dailies today.
Yes.
Why Raila pulled out of Kajwang's Senate seat.
Yes.
I don't know if you were part of the team that wanted him to run for this senatorial seat or the ones who did not want to. Now is the perfect opportunity for you to tell us.
What I can tell you is that that is now water under the bridge. And all I can say is that I'm in support of the Prime Minister for the position that he has taken. Mm-hmm. Leadership, part of leadership is about listening to people. And it took time and listened to what people were telling him. There were those who came to him and told him they wanted him to buy for the senatorial seat with good reasons. And then there are people who also told him not to buy equally with good reasons because
right.
people are going to use it as fodder, especially on the government side, to attack the opposition and to create division. So I want to say, speaking as of now, as of today, I support the position that the Prime Minister took.
Okay, now ODM has been in the newspapers lately. We know about the NGC that happened on Friday.
Yes.
And then now with the senatorial seat and, of course, with the unfortunate passing of Kajwang.
Yes.
But looking futuristically, where do you see ODM in the next year?
Well,
on a time like this next year, what will
yes,
we be saying
I see
about
ODM
it?
Rejuvenated. We've had unfortunate circumstances like the passing on of Senator Kajwang, who was a very strong pillar for the party. Mm-hmm. But you can see, even with the happenings of the NDC, unfortunately, I was away until yesterday. I was in Morocco. I just came back. But I think from what happened at the NDC, you can see rejuvenation, you can see a lot more cohesion, and you can see the party leader has played a very big role mm-hmm. in trying to gel the party, because we've been having challenges in the recent past. The party elections really drew us apart as a party, and it takes leadership and wisdom to do what the party leader did.
Okay.
Yes.
So obviously the party is evolving, as is Jubilee coalition as well.
Yes.
And so the question is, how would you rate them in terms of how they have been running the government up to today? And where do you think the country will be in a year given their current trend of leadership?
Well, I actually took time when I was in Morocco to do an honest assessment of the government. I said, am I critical of the government just because I'm in opposition, or is there something amiss? And one of the things that prompted me to think through that when I was in Morocco was just looking at the infrastructure. Morocco is a country in Africa, and their climatic circumstances are so different mm-hmm. from us, so we have better opportunities to make greater make a lot out of what we have. And then I said, when I look at their infrastructure, which is very, very well developed, mm-hmm. and I could see that there's a legacy that you can attribute to the Kibaki Raila era, which is infrastructure development. And I asked myself, if up to this point, what would I say is an emerging legacy that you would credit with the Uhuru Ruto leadership? Mm-hmm. And unfortunately, there's none. I would credit something emerging with the First Lady, mm-hmm. but not with the government. So it's a sort of a byproduct, which is the issue of maternal health. And for me, because it's
I know you're quite
something I'm very
about
passionate
that,
about.
Yeah.
But beyond that, beyond the zero, really there is a zero. Beyond the zero, there's zero.
Beyond the zero, you think there's zero?
There's zero.
There are people who are saying perhaps we should give this government a little more time and we'll see what will happen. And I know you've been very specific.
Yes.
You said an emerging legacy.
Yes.
Could it be that we'll see it happening later?
An emerging legacy should already be evident. You know, even if you're like a person with a pregnancy, you should be seeing signs, you know, like morning sicknesses, you know, the works.
Yeah.
We are not seeing anything emerging.
You've always been...
We are sort of more divided, and I'm glad the NCIC has done a report that shows Kenya is more divided. I would have expected this government, who is on a platform of youthfulness, to have put in more effort at that, at least, on national cohesion. We are more divided than we were even 2 years ago. I would have seen a lot more emphasis on youth employment. Instead, we are seeing more emphasis on PR, and I think we are taking this PR exercise too far. And it gets fatiguing at some point. It was very trendy and very exciting to see people, you know, doing things that excite us. But you can only be excited for a moment. More like the way I told you when I walked in and I saw your shoes. I love it. But tomorrow, if you wear the same pair of shoes, I'll be like, please.
Thanks for letting the viewers know.
Now I love your shoes. You're looking very good. But if you came wearing the same thing tomorrow, I'll be bored.
So you think it's empty politics?
Too much PR, please. Okay. I think it's time that the government got more serious business, do the PR, but also do serious work.
You're one of those people, Millie, who has never been afraid to criticize government.
Yes.
And you've actually been kicked out of parliament severally because of speaking out of turn.
Yes.
And right now you said, I asked myself while I was in Morocco why I was so critical of the government.
Yes.
And what are those key issues that irk you so badly you have to be this vocal?
Pardon?
What are these issues that make you so upset about the current government that force you to be so vocal?
Yeah, but I've told you, one of them is really that when you see people who are elected on a platform of youthfulness, you need to see it emerging. That we need to see them proving some of us wrong. I need them to make me feel that I shouldn't be in the opposition, I should be supporting them. But really right now, other than poaching people from the opposition like General Nkaiseri, what is this government doing? What is it? I don't feel it, I don't see it, I don't smell it, I don't see anything. I've told you on national cohesion, we are doing zero. Mm-hmm. I've told you on employment, we are doing zero. Infrastructure, all the legacy projects that are going on are from basically they are carry-ons mm-hmm. from the last administration. So what can you say that this government is initiating that we can say from a distance we can smell and we can see?
Okay,
I know 2 years may not be a long time, but and that's why I was actually asking myself. I said, let me give myself a genuine, you know, assessment of this government. And I used myself as an example. And I looked at Mbit and I said, if somebody were to ask me, and which people do, and they tell me, Mbit, what have you done, mm-hmm. you know, like in 2 years? And I can tell you what I've done in 2 years. There are things that are emerging in terms of things that I've done. And I can't say the same thing of this government. And they have a lot more money than some of us.
Okay, we'll come back to the issue of Mbita specifically in a bit. But let's go back to something you've just mentioned. You phrased it very nicely, the poaching of Nkaiseri from opposition.
Yes.
Is that how you see this recent nomination?
Of course. It's both a good and a bad thing. It's a good thing because it shows that the government is acknowledging that the bank for intelligence, for resourcefulness is in the opposition. But it's also a negative thing because the government is thereby trying to weaken opposition. And if you are talking about mature democracies, the focus should be building on the government and development instead of working towards weakening opposition. I know that we are in a competition, but that shouldn't be the primary focus of the government. It should not be how do we weaken opposition, but how do we deliver for Kenyans. And I'm seeing the government more focused on how to weaken opposition and not how to build on Kenya.
Okay. Speaking of opposition, let's look at Kajiado Central specifically.
Yes.
I know you've had there people who have said if Nkaiseri does get this job, then ODM should get an automatic slot for the position of Kajiado Central.
Yes.
Do you think this is the case, or do you think this is what should happen?
Ideally, that should happen, but we are not living in an ideal world. In an ideal world, there is competition, and we know that Jubilee will also fill their own candidates. But in an ideal situation, it should have been given directly to ODM, because in any event, it is our person that has been poached. And it ties basically to what I was telling you, that when you poach from the opposition, then you are trying to essentially weaken the opposition and render opposition, useless or weak. But we need an effective opposition to oversight the government. So if you're a government that does not want to be oversighted, then what does it tell of you as a government?
Okay.
Yeah.
Moving now to your personal story.
Yes.
I know your father was into regional politics.
Yes.
And so this is something that you've done for a while. You were nominated MP before you were Mbita MP.
Yes.
The things that you're learning and how you're growing, both as a politician and as a leader, that you can tell us about.
Oh, there are so many things that I cannot even say, like
the three key ones. And
well, I wouldn't
specifically as a female politician, because I imagine it's a lot different from the senator who was here.
Yes, I know. And what I would tell you is that I've written it in a book. I think I've told you before, Politics Unpackaged, Lessons for Aspiring Women. And the reason I've written this is that there's so much to learn, almost on a daily basis. But one of the significant lessons I've learned is that as a woman, the first challenge you face is that men cannot deal with strong women. So you will be fought left, right, and center.
But they don't even term them as strong women. I've heard you referred to as bossy, as arrogant, as pushy. Do you find that this is because you're female?
Mainly because you find men who are stronger than me, who are bossier than me, who are more vocal than me, and nobody uses those adjectives on them. The reason is really just that from our socialization, people are not used to women who are strong. And all manner of excuses will be given, but ultimately, you will always have a challenge with a woman who is strong. I'll give you an example of Honorable Martha Karua. If you look at it, and I'm sorry to use this as an example, which is another challenge I face. I'm too blunt and very honest ordinarily.
Oh, this is Morning Express. You're allowed to express yourself openly.
Exactly. So I'll tell you that Kenyan politics is ethnic. And I'll tell you from Martha Karua perspective that if there's one person that has stood and fought, one for the country, but also for the interests of the Kikuyu, it is Martha Karua. But look at when the decision was being made to choose the successor in politics. Martha was shoved aside, not because she had any sins. She just made the unfortunate mistake of being a woman and a strong one. So that was her first mistake. Look at Priscilla Nyokabi. Suddenly, it just occurred to some people in the TNA party that Priscilla Nyokabi worked in Kituo cha Sheria that gave a list to, or purportedly gave a list to ICC. Why didn't they notice that when she was vying for the seat? It's because she's an emerging strong woman. Suddenly in my own party, people have decided I look like a mole, even though I'm called the Mrembo Wasuba, but my features apparently seem to appear to them like a mole. And I'm not deterred, because I know it is part of the challenges you have to face as a woman leader, that the moment you come out as a strong woman leader, people will try and pull you down.
Okay, and so specifically on the issue of you being alleged to be a mole, first of all, are you a mole? Let's just get that out of the way.
From the looks, do I look like a mole?
I don't know what a mole looks like, maybe.
Just take a mole as a mole. It's an animal that, you know what a mole is.
Yes.
I don't even remotely look like one. I am called Mrembo Wasuba. I do not, and I cannot.
Is it easier to pick on female politicians
because
they're perceived to be softer and gentler?
Not softer and gentler. They will pick on you when they think you are strong. So if I was an underperforming woman politician, nobody would call me a mole. I can assure you about that. I am only a mole because I am strong, I speak my mind, and I say when I see something wrong, I will call it wrong. So then that makes me a mole.
There are those, however, who say, because you're saying they're underperforming female politicians as well.
Yes.
But they have been used as the example against affirmative action. People are saying there's no need to have a third representation of women in parliament or in the National Assembly or anywhere for that matter if they're not performing. Are they performing or are we being unfair?
I think we are being unfair. I think the women are doing the best. First of all, I can tell you that we have a new parliament which is much bigger than the last parliament. And because of that, and again, unfortunately, that members were not effectively inducted into the way the system works. There's always this feel that we are in a hurry and all motions and bills must be finished on the same day. So because of that, women don't get opportunity to speak even when they log in. And it's another challenge of being digital, that when you log in as opposed to the old parliament, if the women were standing, would see that they are trying to speak. But right now, even if you try and log in, nobody will see that you're trying. So it's how you perform is not dependent on you. It's dependent on the speaker giving you the opportunity. And unless you are a bit of a nutcase like myself, that forced their way.
And I was about to say that, because despite all these things that you're talking about, you've still managed to fight your way through all the systemic issues you're referring to and be the strong politician that you are today.
Because you have to kick your way into being seen. If you don't kick your way into being seen, it's unfortunate. One of the women politicians that I've quoted in my book told me, Millie, one of the things I've learned, she's a new politician, and she told me, Millie, one of the things I've learned is that in politics, for my own safety, I have to perform below average. So there are women who also deliberately perform below average so that they are not targets. Because they've learned if you perform above average, you become an easy target. Now, some of us have allowed ourselves to be easy targets because only then can you actually see the capability of women leadership. Because if you don't, if we all perform below average for our own protection, then people will tell you we all came into parliament to be flower girls. But still, I think even with those challenges, the women members of parliament are doing fairly very well, if you ask me.
Okay, and so what is this that keeps you so motivated and re-energized that it doesn't matter to you whether you're a target, whether people say this about you, whether they call you a mole, that you still keep pursuing what you think is right?
Because my vision is intact. I never get into things unless I believe in them. And once I believe in something, I am not distracted because it's part of my faith system. I'm not into politics because politics happens. I believe it's part of my greater calling as a Christian to be in politics. And because of that, I do not care what all these things, I see them as, you know, irrelevant sideshows.
Yeah.
I am targeted on my aim and I'm headed there.
In, say, 2017, when we talk about Millie Odhiambo, what do you want us to say?
If 2017...
I know it's a short target.
It's a short target. I thought you were going to say one day when I'm gone and whatever.
No. I'm talking about 2017.
Don't say yeah, lies
are because lying, I want to hear what to specific dreams and visions you have from Bita.
Well, if you want to think about the dreams and vision I have from Bita, I have quite a number of projects, but I want to make a difference. I want to do I want to make a difference in the lives of women, in the lives of youth, in the lives of the older persons, in the life of the religious sector, in the life of the fishing and agricultural community.
Yeah.
So for me, really, it's about making sure that when 2017 comes, I can look back and say that in all those sectors that I've mentioned, I did one, two, three things, and that their lives was impacted by my leadership.
Yeah.
I did not just happen. I was not just one other politician.
Okay.
But that there was a difference that was brought by, I would maybe call it a motherly instinct. I think it brings a difference.
Okay.
That we feel communities.
And I think there's something that you definitely feel that we're all aware of, which is the social development of women and children.
Exactly.
And you spoke out very strongly about Akello when she was being bombarded for wearing a tight skirt. I'm just curious to know what you, if you think enough is being done in the country to stop this untoward violence towards women, especially now in public where we're seeing stripping.
No, I don't think so. I don't think enough is being done. I am glad that the other day, there was this launch of the 16 days, and I like giving credit where it's due. Mm. In many years since I've worked in the sector, this is the first time at the highest level that I've seen the commitment to, not commitment I would call it, but really even at the launch level, that we have looked at the issue of 16 days of activism at the presidential level. But I'd want us to go beyond, again, talking about the PR. It was very good PR. But if the president was committed to issues of eradicating issues of violence against women, then the moment, for instance, we have seen, I've seen another viral thing on people in Kisii who undressed another woman. Mm-hmm. If I was a president, I would be on their case, you know, whatever.
But
because
I mean,
we need to hear his voice stronger and firmer on such issues. And if I were him, I would have already directed that those people be arrested because their faces are clear. And unfortunately, including a woman who thought it was a very interesting thing, they should arrest, including that woman. Mm. Yeah.
Okay, but why do you think our elected representatives are so quiet on this issue? We're not hearing, for example, opposition or even elected people from the Jubilee Coalition coming out to speak openly against it.
We have actually spoken very strongly, especially the women parliamentarians. Mm-hmm. The women parliamentarians have done a whole lot of things in relation to this. We've even met the cabinet secretary, Anne Waiguru, over this issue.
Yeah.
And part of our, we are fortunately, as KEWOPA, Kenya Women Parliamentarians Association, we are launching our strategic plan tomorrow. And the issues of violence against women is going to feature very strongly. They were part of the team that was demonstrating with the Kilimani Moms.
Yes.
And I must say, I'm very happy with the Kilimani Moms. If you are watching, kudos, you are doing a very good job.
And apart from that, I know that from as early as 2010, you are already drafting bills that you hoped would go through the entire legislation process that sought to protect the rights of women and children.
Yes.
How far have those gone, and do you have something in the works right now?
Yes, there are some in the works, but most of them have actually gone through.
Yeah.
I told you, I'm very clear and I'm very focused. In my agenda, I don't get distracted by sideshows and all these political irrelevancies. I'm very clear what I'm doing at the national level. I'm very clear what I'm doing at the Mbita level. Mm-hmm. At the national level, which covers and encompasses every woman, in the last parliament, I brought the Counter-Trafficking in Persons Act, which passed. In this parliament, I brought the Victim Protection Act, which protects victims of crime, including, for instance, these women who are being undressed. And the government must compensate victims like that under the new law that I passed. I also passed under this parliament the Treaty Making and Ratification Act. And the Treaty Making and Ratification Act, when you hear it, it sounds very all fancy and stuff. But all I did, which I thank God for that I'm a lawyer, was in a very clever way import treaties that are protective of women through that act. For instance, the Convention on the Elimination of All Forms of Discrimination Against Women, the Declaration on Violence Against Women, and a whole lot of other conventions on children and women are now part of the laws of Kenya.
Okay.
So whenever you see all this happening now at institutional level, non-governmental organizations can go to court and benefit from this law that I passed. There are, of course, other laws that are still in the offing. Of course, the controversial one that I initiated on in vitro fertilization, which is also there, and I've seen part of the church very opposed to it. Mm-hmm. I'm hoping to get time to explain to them that that is a reality.
Why don't we explore that now, especially because we have a gynecologist coming into studio who is talking about fertility.
Yes.
Why is this important and why does it need legislation?
It's important because it's a reality. I told you again, I'm a very honest person, so I'll tell you from my example. I don't have a child. If I decided to have a child, I'm not very young, it would be very difficult. I would explore those options with my gyno. Mm-hmm. If, for instance, my husband lives or generally lives more out of the country than in the country. So I have all factors that militate against me having a child naturally.
Right.
And I do not want, as a person brought up in the church and who is a believer, I do not want to do what other people would do in the circumstances, which is get a baby by somebody else and parade it as my husband's mm-hmm. child. So which is the other option for me? In vitro fertilization. It is a reality. It is happening. It is not unlawful, but there is no legislative framework. Honorable Joyce Lay has already had a child through in vitro fertilization.
Yeah, I actually followed that story. And
exactly.
Did it,
yeah. So those are options. And if the church has concerns about people misusing, I think what they need to do is say, okay, how do we address the issues that people would misuse such a framework? How would we address it in law? Instead of burying our heads in mm-hmm. the sand, like the proverbial ostrich, because as I've said, and I would want to repeat, that doing in vitro fertilization is not unlawful.
Mm-hmm.
So it's going on, and we cannot stop it because it's not unlawful. Unlike abortion, for instance, which is unlawful in Kenya. In vitro fertilization is not unlawful. So it's going on, but
with no policy to govern
no
how
policy,
it's done.
With no policy, no legislation to guide it.
Okay.
Yeah.
And so how do we get these conversations? Because you've said a controversial bill because it touches on in vitro fertilization.
Yes.
And when we talk about public stripping of women, we have to be very politically correct on gender issues. They've suddenly become women issues. How do we get those issues from being spoken of in low tones, in families, and elevate them to the national platform where they deserve to be? I mean, in the Standard newspaper today, we are reporting that over 49% of women say they have gone through some form of gender abuse.
Yes. Well, what I can say is that to some degree, I'm happy that the silence has been broken to some degree. When I started working in the sector, I used to be the chairperson on the Coalition on Violence Against Women. I worked with FIDA. And I've worked in the sector for very many years. And I can tell you.
And you founded Cradle.
And I founded the Cradle. And I can tell you that as at 97, when I started working, when I first did a case where a lady called Agnes Yankoi took the husband to court on violence, it was reported internationally because it was breaking news that a Kenyan woman has taken the husband to court. Right now, if a woman takes the husband to court, it will not be breaking news unless it's a politician like me if I go to court because my husband has beaten. But beyond that, now we are actually talking, except we need to talk more.
Mm-hmm.
We need to get behind our doors, especially on issues of incest. There's a lot of cases of incest. And also be stronger, especially from the highest level of leadership.
Mm-hmm.
And we want especially the male leadership, so that it's not gendered. We want Uhuru Kenyatta, we want William Ruto to talk very strongly against violence against women.
Mm-hmm.
And it should not be an occasional thing, an occasional PR exercise. It should be sustained. Then the people who are doing these acts will know that the government does not condone it.
Okay, so as you mentioned, 97 is when you founded the Cradle.
Yes.
But in 96, you were very much rooted into, you know, works of civil society.
Exactly.
And you were out there.
Yes.
And you were already vocalizing what you thought was wrong, and you were being beaten and you didn't care.
Yes.
What has happened to such people? Why aren't we seeing young people doing that? Are we losing it?
Are youth
so disjointed with what's happening to them? Are we so oblivious to our world? We don't care what happens to it?
Well, it's both the fact that there's a disconnect. A lot of the youth, when you tell them, I talk to my nieces, and a lot of them, when you tell them that we lived in my time, not in the time of my mother, but in my youth, which is not too long ago, there were days when if you wanted to read certain literature, you'd lock yourself in the toilet and get somebody by the gate to see whether there's a government agent coming to see what you're reading. And they were fairly harmless. And when I was doing one of the reports at one point for the 50th anniversary of the Universal Declaration of Human Rights, I came across a person who was jailed for saying that one day you'll be surprised to see Kibaki as a president of Kenya. And the guy served time. for saying such things. And it was not in another era, it was in my time. So a lot has changed in terms of the opening of democratic space. But for you who are younger, because you didn't see it, you think it just happened. Some of us fought. I was almost shot by a police. I was beaten severely by the police for agitating for this space. Of course, you have the doyens of this struggle, mm-hmm. The Railas and you know, all those people in that league.
And the faces that we see every
Martha
time.
Karua's,
post, yeah.
Yeah. Who fought so much? And for us, we were younger, but we are supporting as the younger liberation team with the people like Cecily Mbarire, Kabando wa Kabando. We did a lot of work then. But because of the younger people who didn't see it, we take certain things for granted. We take the freedom of speech for granted. We take a whole lot of things for granted. And I've been finding it a bit worrisome, mm-hmm. that there has been a thinning of that space since the new administration came in. There's a little bit of intolerance that is stemming in. There's a little bit of taking away of that democratic space that we fought so hard for, and some of us will not allow it.
But then there's also another space which is opening up, which is the online platforms.
Yes.
And this has globalized the world in a way that I don't even think we saw coming.
Yes.
Are we using it effectively and efficiently enough to get our voices heard? Because if today I'm told I can't sit outside Harambee House, then I can use that voice to lobby support on Facebook, on Twitter, on Instagram, or whatever other platforms there are.
That's a good platform, though in Kenya we also use it very badly. Mm-hmm. Unfortunately, we tend to use it much more for demonizing other ethnic communities and people we don't like. But it is a very powerful platform. The only challenge, of course, is that there is a research that was done very recently by one of our development partners that was shared with us as Kewopa. Mm-hmm. And it shows that only 0.something in Kenya use Facebook,
for instance,
social media. So it's a powerful tool, especially in urban centers. But I think we need to encourage more usage of the social social media. And especially because, unfortunately, again, being very honest, I think the media is increasingly going to bed with the government. Yeah, that's something that I don't like.
Okay.
Yes.
So speaking as a person who is viewing the situation externally,
yes,
what would you do to correct that?
Well, for me, one of the things that we do to correct that is, of course, consistently speaking out against those ills and pushing that agenda from a parliamentary perspective. Mm-hmm. And that's why you see me always being thrown out, being punished right now by the Parliamentary Privileges Committee. I don't know how many hundreds of thousands I'm supposed to pay for allegedly breaking chairs and tables and God knows whatever else.
Did you actually break those chairs?
No, unless I'm super woman. How do I break those chairs? If you go and sit on those chairs, you'd actually understand what I'm saying. So somebody was a little too excited.
Okay, even yes. As you're telling me that you're being punished and you have to pay hundreds of thousands, for some other person, they might be deeply concerned by that. They might not even want to bring it up on national TV. But do you enjoy being an outlier? Do you not mind it?
Well, I don't mind it. This is who I am. I cannot be anybody else. Uh-huh. The Bible tells me I'm fearfully and wonderfully made. That's who I am.
Rembo
I do not want to be anything else. I was born vocal. I was born truthful. I was born honest. I do not want to be anybody else, because God looked and said, wonderful. So
okay.
I'm just happy being who I am.
There is a temptation and also the need to ask women how they're able to juggle their family life together with politics.
Yes.
But I'm going to ask you a different question. Do you miss being a lawyer exclusively? Do you miss when you were not in politics?
Sometimes, yes. I miss the professional. I miss the technical work. Like now, I've just come from Morocco, where we were doing a lot of, even though the work was around the ICC, I'm the chairperson in Kenya of what we call the Parliamentarians for Global Action, mm-hmm. that works on human rights and rule of law. And we are talking very professionally about the ICC, and of course the Kenyan issue came up. And I miss that. I miss dealing with the technical issues. I miss, sometimes I'm called as a technical or as an expert even now, of course voluntarily. to you know, international forum. Like last year, I was giving input on victim protections, law internationally on counter trafficking. So I miss doing that. That I won't cheat you, mm-hmm. because I'm not able to do that as much as when I'm in parliament. Because in parliament, again, I've said, unfortunately, it's one, in my book, I say it's one place where we do not also recognize expertise or professionalism, where a mortician can be the chairperson of the Committee on Justice. So you get used to it.
Some might argue that is a price of democracy.
Yeah, it is. It is.
Okay. Yeah. And so, having brought up the issue of the ICC, you know, I have to ask you what you think about the recent decision by Fatou Bensouda to withdraw the charges, or rather the case against President Uhuru Kenyatta, without any prejudice.
Yes. What I would want to say is, I think, speaking as a Kenyan politician, I think it's one of those things that is good that happened. And the reason why I think it's good is that every ill in Kenya has been blamed on ICC, mm-hmm. including accusing people to have taken the president there, when we know as Kenyans that the people like Honorable Raila Amolo Odinga, who was being accused to have taken the names there, did not. I was in the last parliament, and those are the things I was saying at that forum, where we were very clear as parliament, do not be vague, let's go to the Hague. Mm-hmm. And how a chorus in parliament became Honorable Raila Odinga just beats me. So for me, it now gives us the opportunity to focus full attention on the presidency, because everything has been excused on ICC. Mm-hmm. If the roads are not being made, it's because of ICC. If our children are dying of hunger, ICC. If I don't know what happens, ICC. Now ICC is not there. We are focusing on the performance of the president.
Okay, but even as we focus on now developmental issues, and a lot of people have said what you've spoken about, that with the removal of ICC, it opens up avenues for other things.
Yes.
But there's also the question of justice for the victims, and the same parliament you were in, 2009, began debate on legislation that would potentially see a tribunal created in Kenya to sort out the ills of 2007. That debate still hasn't concluded.
Yes.
Are the politicians letting us down with regard to that?
Yes, the politicians are letting you down, and I can assure you, because it touches on politicians.
And when we say politicians, we include you.
Yes. And I would want to tell you, because of that, do not hold your breath. There is not likely to be any justice in terms of criminalization on ICC cases because of the political nature of it. So do not hold your breath there. But for me, I said, because at least we need to give some level of justice for victims, mm-hmm. that's why I came with the Victim Protection Bill that looks at issues of restitution. So that even if you are not able to deal with issues of the justice in terms of a criminal justice system, then at least we need to look at justice in the civil sector in terms of restitution for the victims. And so that I brought it, in a more pragmatic approach, so that it doesn't just look at the victims of the post-election violence. Right. But in a broader sense.
Okay.
So I've told you I'm a fairly focused person. I kind of thought the ICC would go the way it did. So for me, being empathetic to victims and coming from my background of human rights, I proactively brought a bill which is already law on victims' protection.
And finally, because we're wrapping up and we're running out of time, I do have to ask you the same question I asked Mutula Kilonzo Jr.
Yes.
If you were to stand in front of the people of Mbita today and say, Millie Odhiambo, as your MP, I have performed at this percentage so far, what grade would you give yourself?
At 2 years, I would tell you very quickly that the first few months I got in, I went to every single village. So I know every single nook of my constituents, including places I did not go to when I was seeking for votes. And I went there to, first of all, say thank you. And secondly, to get their views in terms of what work they want us to do for them. Secondly, after that, I have worked around the CDF, given assistance with the CDF. Then I have gone all around again, the mm-hmm. constituency, doing monitoring and evaluation. It sounds simple, but it's not so easy. It's a very difficult thing, going to every single village. Took me, the first round took me almost
how many villages? How many villages did you go to?
Wow, villages are over, I would call it, because they are tiny little, they are over 200. So I went to over 200. So I've done that twice. And then I've also had the sublocational, basically, an open space so that people can question the work that we are doing in CDF and all that. Mm-hmm. So on the whole, I would give myself 80%. And I would give myself 80% because I have noticed there are challenges, especially in terms of the workings of my office, which I have listened to the public. They've been giving me communication mm-hmm. about the things they don't like, which I am in the process of dealing with, one of which was seeking the immediate transfer of my fund account manager, who was not serving the people of Mbita well. So yes, I like doing a very honest self-assessment. So far, I would put it at 80%. I am in touch very much with my ground. I go to Mbita at least 3 times in a month. I am in touch with the issues that are coming. Of course, the challenges for me is that we don't have sufficient resources. I am already in the process of coming up with a SACO mm-hmm. For women, training women and doing a SACO for them. I have a program for women which is called WAGEDI, Women and Girls Education and Development Initiative.
Yes.
I am already running a mentorship program for girls in schools. I am doing a similar project for the youth which is called My Time. Resources is a big challenge. But with that, that's why I removed the 20. If I had the resources with my civil society background, I would be at 120%. I would be at 120%.
I think that's a good place to wrap up this interview. Very self-assured member of parliament from Mbita, Millie Odhiambo, saying she would give herself 80%. And guess what? Dare her if you can. Challenge her if you dare, rather. And that is where we wind up person of interest.